When I was a young girl, the 21st century seemed so far away. Now, we don't really need to quantify exact ages here, but let's just suffice it to say, it's about the time that Prince was on the radio crooning about how we were going to party like it was 1999. And I was right there with him, because I knew the 2000s were going to be amazing. And one reason I was so excited is because I thought this would be mine, right? The flying car? Was anybody there with me? Okay, so I haven't gotten my flying car yet. Maybe one day, but not yet. I did get one thing, though, that my young imagination never even dreamt of, and that was the internet, the web. Now, that one I didn't see coming. And when my daughter had her first book report due in school, I was trying to explain to her what it was like in my day before the internet. So I said, okay, I had to go to this library, I had to actually drive there, and I used this thing called the Dewey Decimal System. It was about at that point that I looked over and she was looking at me like I was 200 years old. And she said, Mom, you have to be really old to not even have the internet. So the funny part about that is, though, I kind of got where she was coming from at that moment, because even to me explaining it, it already seemed so archaic. And it got me to thinking, I'm not here today to talk about flying cars, which would be fun, or the internet, but what is that disruptive technology, that thing that's going to change the world so much and become so embedded in my daughter's everyday life that their children will look at them with shock and dismay when they find out it didn't exist in the not-so-distant past? Well, our story today actually starts with the printing press. Now, the printing press is heralded as one of the greatest inventions of all time, and for good reason. It was the start of the Renaissance. And that's because it brought information and knowledge to the common citizen for the first time in history. And we're getting ready to embark on another renaissance with 3D printing. Now, 3D printing, the same way that the printing press was able to bring that information and knowledge available to the common citizen, 3D printing will bring goods. Now, the technical term for 3D printing is called additive manufacturing. And I don't know about you, but for me, when I hear the word manufacturing, I think of images like this one. Large facilities and mass production and a lot of time with a big workforce. But 3D printing actually brings that whole supply chain to the individual. And it liberates us by reducing our dependency on others for what we need. So that whole manufacturing life cycle from the concept of the part to the finished product is now put in the individual's hands. And as a matter of fact, I was so excited about today's event, and I thought my outfit deserved a little extra flair. So my necklace today was 3D printed just for this event, so you can have a lot of fun with it as well. This really levels the playing field, because you can be in the most remote country cabin, or you can be in the biggest city. And now that playing field is leveled, because that capability and that supply chain is brought to you. But what about here? Space. Now, this is where it goes from being novel or a nice to have to be an absolute, beyond a shadow of a doubt, game changer. And that's because we've had a few significant hurdles during the space program that we repeatedly experience. And these hurdles are particularly challenging when it comes to exploration missions to further out destinations, places like the Mars or Moon or asteroids. And those challenges are mass, risk, and cost. And they're all very much interconnected. So from the inception of the human space program, we have always had to launch what we need, anything we need, from the Earth at a cost of $10,000 per pound. And that's a cost, by the way, that we've never been able to reduce. So we have a very limited and constrained supply chain, to put it mildly. And this mass risk and cost are further compounded by other factors. Number one, if you have a part that is critical to your mission, then you must fly spares, which adds more to your mass. Secondly, the structural requirements to survive the launch loads from escaping Earth's gravity, again, add more mass and cost. And lastly, and maybe most importantly, NASA has done an amazing job making this work thus far, but for these further out destinations, it's just not feasible. The cost and the time and the risk associated are just not realistic. Now, I've got a fun anecdote when we talk about mass, and for me, this really put it into perspective. Many of you are familiar with the Saturn V vehicle as part of the Apollo program. And on the launch pad, the Saturn V weighed 6,600,000 pounds. Now, the part that actually returned, this little tiny red circle up there, the command module, only weighed 12,800 pounds. Now, to put that into further perspective, that's like if you go on a road trip in your car, and the only thing you return with are the front left wheel's lug nuts. That is a lot of difference in mass. So I want to tell you that today, NASA is actually 3D printing rocket propulsion components. And in the near future, we hope to 3D print a rocket engine. Now, I can't really go on talking about the space program without talking about risk for a moment. Risk is inherent to what we do, and I could give you many examples of times when we didn't have exactly what we needed when we needed during space missions. But one of the most famous, thanks in part to Tom Hanks, is Apollo 13. And many of you might even be familiar with the square peg and the round hole dilemma. In space, we have to be able to scrub the carbon dioxide from the atmosphere, or the crew will die. And when the Apollo 13 crew had to transfer to the temporary rescue ship, they found that the command ship's filters were square and the rescue ship's filter barrel was round. So if you watch the movie, you already know that this heroic ground crew devised an ingenious solution on how to cannibalize parts on orbit to fix the problem. But now let's stop for a minute and think, what if that Apollo 13 crew had a 3D printer? Well, the company Made in Space, Inc. wondered that too, and they did a really neat exercise. They brought in a high school intern, and they familiarized him with the problem at hand, and they asked him if he could devise a 3D printed fix. And he did in one day. He was actually to not only devise the solution, but implement the solution in one day. So if we stop and think about this for a minute, that means that a high school student was given a capability to devise and implement a solution to a previously life-threatening technical problem. Pretty cool, huh? Well, we thought so too. And that's why we're flying the first ever 3D printer to space this month on the SpaceX 4 rocket to the International Space Station. 3D printing and zero-G technology demonstration is a partnership between NASA and the company Made in Space, Inc. through the Small Business Innovation Research Program. Now, as you might gather from Made in Space's name, their whole business model is on enabling human exploration in space. And we at NASA believe that 3D printing is a key and fundamental enabler to doing just that. Now, before I go a lot further, I get a question a lot of how do I go from this? This is our raw feedstock. It looks pretty unassuming, to be quite honest. It actually, we get a comment a lot, it looks like your weed eater feed line at home. For those who weed eat, I don't, but it does look like that. To this, which is a highly customized TEDx Huntsville 3D printed part. It's pretty straightforward, the process. Just like your printer at home receives an electronic message that tells it exactly where to place the ink to make the words or images that you specified, the 3D printer receives an electronic message also called a computer-aided design, or CAD, model. Now, the 3D printer then knows it heats up the plastic into small plastic beads, and it puts those beads exactly where it needs to per that electronic image to build the part you specify. So on the printer we're flying to space station, we'll actually be uplinking these CAD models to the space station, to the printer directly, and we'll be operating the printer mostly from the ground, turning it on and off and operating the actual prints. The only thing that we don't do from the ground is astronauts have to remove the print from the print tray. So let's stop and think about that for a moment. Now we're talking about a history-making moment in time, because we're talking about, for the first time ever, transitioning to launching our hardware to space. Now we're talking about emailing our hardware to space. Now that may sound like science fiction, but it's not. It's very soon to be science fact. And if you remember those pesky launch loads I talked about earlier, well, if you're building the hardware in space now, you're obviously not launching it, so you don't have launch loads. But not only that, now that you can actually build that hardware in the microgravity environment, it opens up the design process and options in ways that we've never had the opportunity to do. The technology demonstration actually has two phases, and the first phase of the demonstration will be to demonstrate that the printer and the process work in microgravity just like it does on Earth. Now, the company Made in Space has actually flown multiple flights on the aptly named Vomit Comet, and they have found that the prints have equitable quality to those printed on the ground. However, those flights, you only get 20 to 30 second spurts of microgravity. And even a small part, something like a clip, will take about 15 minutes. So the International Space Station is literally our only platform in the universe at this time where we can print an entire part in microgravity. We'll also be able to get some immediate data and feedback because we'll have high definition cameras on the windows of the printer. And from that, we'll be able to watch the prints as they're happening live. And we'll also get some data such as we're very interested in seeing if the plastic layers are deposited the same way as they are in gravity. Now, the initial parts that we print, we will be bringing back to the ground. And these will include things like tensile and torque and range coupons. And we'll do detailed engineering analysis in comparison to our ground control samples. The second phase of the technology demonstration will turn our focus more toward the actual parts we're printing and demonstrating their usefulness on the space station. And this would include things like you might imagine. You've got crew tools and science hardware and payload equipment, replacement parts for things like exercise equipment, medical tools, and even things like small satellite components. But the part I get most excited about is when I stop and think the first time we get the call from an astronaut and they request that thing that actually none of us even thought about. And mark my words, that will happen. Now, I'll be the first one to tell you that 3D printing in space is only the first step toward establishing those sustainable technologies that we'll really need to enable exploration. We'll need an integrated suite of capabilities, and that will have to include things like a recycler that will take that part that we printed and recycle it back into that raw feedstock that we can reuse. At NASA, we actually awarded two Phase 1 Small Business Innovation Awards this year to two companies that are doing just that. They're developing an in-space recycler that I hope we will end up flying as a technology demonstration, just like we're doing with the printer. Now, in addition, the in-space manufacturing vision includes things like printable electronics, also how to come up with a technology for printing metals, just like we do with the plastics, in microgravity. That's a little trickier. And even printing small satellites and nanosats. And NASA has an exploration roadmap, and in-space manufacturing is critical to bringing that roadmap to fruition. Now, ultimately, though, we'll be able to need to use the in-situ resources of wherever we travel, whether that be the moon or Mars or asteroids, as the raw resource to build what we need, such as structural habitats, radiation shielding, landing pads, and storage shelters. And that technology to build larger structures actually does exist today as well. It's called contour crafting. And at NASA, we are working with other entities to further develop this technology. So you might imagine someone like the Army or the Corps of Engineers or FEMA being interested in this. They could use soil or sand to build structures during military deployment or natural disasters. I would love to go to Mars. It would be fantastic, but realistically, it probably won't be someone from my generation to first step foot on the red planet. And I just realized this talk's making me feel really old. But more than likely, it's a student that's out there today. And I have wanted to work for NASA since I was 7. It is all I thought about. And I feel very passionately that we have to spark the excitement and also foster the skill sets in the younger generation today to make sure that we do what it takes to enable human exploration. So what better way to do that than for a student to have his or her part that they designed to be printed on the International Space Station? So we're gonna do just that with a program called Future Engineers. It's a Space Act agreement between NASA and the American Society of Mechanical Engineers. And the winning student will have his or her part printed on space station as they watch live from the Payload Mission Control Center here in Huntsville at Marshall Space Flight Center. Now, can you imagine adding that to your resume before you even go to college? So unfortunately, I don't have a lot of time to talk about this today, although I could go on for hours about all the ways we could use this capability. But to really sum it all up, to be able to make what you need, when you need it, wherever you're located, it truly has greater implications than even we can imagine today. And we're on the cusp of a new manufacturing renaissance. And just like that first printing press, we're only at the first step. But great things are yet to come on Earth and in space. Now, I couldn't help myself, but I have to leave y'all with one parting thought. And for those of you that don't get it, I apologize. You have to Google it when you get home, but I could not resist. The moment for me when I know that we've truly arrived, we've truly made it, is when I can just press a button and say, you got it. Everybody say it with me. Tea, Earl Grey, hot. Thank you very much.